So this is about coherence, consistency, and deja vu, memory hierarchies in the era of specialization. The work that I'm going to talk about today, most of it I have done with my students, Jonathan Alsop, Rakesh Komuravilli, Matt Sinclair, and Hyojin Sung. But I will also be touching on a large amount of work I've done over the last 25 years, more than 25 years, with many, many colleagues and students as well. Okay, so end of Moore's Law is here, or will soon be here, or at some point will be here. But whatever it is, we are crawling towards the end, and architects have proposed two possible solutions to address this problem. The first is parallelism, and the second is specialization, right? So put many cores together to work on your problem, add a lower voltage and frequency to reduce energy, and specialization being that you specialize your hardware for the application at hand, and that's how you get more energy and are more efficient, etc. Right. However, the problem is that these techniques impact software, of course they impact hardware, and they impact the hardware-software interface. Now, this talk is going to focus on the memory hierarchy for heterogeneous parallel systems, when you're bringing together a whole bunch of specialized components into a parallel architecture, what happens to the memory hierarchy? Because the memory hierarchy is a big obstacle to improving performance, as well as a big consumer of energy. Okay, so again, the memory hierarchy affects software, hardware, as well as the interface. I'm going to talk about how we achieve a global address space in memory hierarchies for such systems, because that's how that's a big part of making the memory hierarchies is easier to program and affecting software. I'm going to talk about coherence, which is the meat of the hardware when it comes to the memory hierarchy. And I'm going to talk about consistency, which is the meat of the hardware-software interface. All right? But before we go there, first, I want to tell you a little bit of my story. Okay, why do I want to tell you the story? Because I think it's important to see the process, okay, the thinking that has brought me here to the point of the kind of systems that we build today and the message that I want to convey today. Okay, so I'm going to start from the point when I was a new graduate student. I was constantly working with my advisor, Mark Hill. I went to him and he said, hey, here are some papers on memory models. Go figure this stuff out. Okay? So what is a memory consistency model? Now, at that time, just like today, there were lots of papers on this subject and a lot of debate, okay, but not much consensus at that time. But there was one thing that people believed and everybody would agree on, and that was that the simplest model is sequential consistency. Right? And we all know what sequential consistency is, I think. It's when memory operations execute one at a time in program order. Right? So you have this view, the programmer has this nice view of single monolithic memory that is executing memory accesses of each thread in that thread's program order, and then the effect is an interleaving among the different threads. So this is a simple model, simple for programmers, but the problem is that it's inefficient in the sense that there are several optimizations in the hardware and the compiler that this model prohibits, or at least they're hard to do. Right? And so at that time, there were many, many hardware vendors that were trying to get around this problem, and they all had this very implementation, sort of optimization-centric view. They had, you know, lots of optimizations they wanted to do, and these optimizations became the basis of a large number of memory models. Effectively, the memory model became the thing that basically said what order different memory operations are allowed to execute in. Okay, so you know, some models said, okay, if I have a store followed by a load, I'm not going to maintain that ordering. I'm going to allow these to be reordered. But if the programmer wants to impose that order, then I'm going to give the programmer some fence-like instructions, and the programmer can put that in. Right? So, and then another vendor had their other version of the story. Okay, so these models proliferated. The problem was they were very complex. They were vague and ambiguous. So for example, yeah, a store before a load can be reordered, but what about being reordered? What if the store and the load were to the same location? What about the order of that with respect to the processor that was issuing it? Is that store allowed to appear earlier than that load to this processor, to other processors? How is it going to be available to other processors at the same time? And there's a whole plethora of complexities, corner cases that weren't quite resolved to satisfaction. And sometimes these ambiguities were just out of, just deliberate because vendors were unwilling to commit to supporting in one decision versus another for perpetuity. Okay, so that was the way things were at that time. My first aha moment that I can remember was, and this is kind of simple, but it really made a difference in my head, it was, you know what, this memory model stuff is not about what order things are gonna perform in. Okay, the fundamental thing here is the memory model is telling me what value a read can return, right? This is very fundamental. I mean, how much more fundamental can you get, right? What value is a read supposed to return? Okay, so this is what we are after here, right? Now, that's why this is such an important hardware-software interface problem. Obviously, it affects performance, obviously, it affects programmability, and it affects portability. All right, so once that happened, so then the next question, the next observation was, all right, so now if it's about what value a read's going to return, then this becomes suddenly a software issue. All right, so I took the software-centric view, and with my advisor, Mark Hill, we came up with this model of data race 3 that Dan talked about, and this is observes that if your program is data race 3, then you get then I will give you sequential consistency. So why is this a good model? Well, first, all it requires really is that the programmer can continue to write programs like as if they were working on a sequentially consistent system. All they have to do is identify which memory accesses are involved in a race and which are not. And the ones that are not racy are the only ones they can call data. Okay, so they have to distinguish what's data, what's synchronization, and the racy ones are the synchronization accesses. All right? And the reason this works is that the non-racy accesses, the data accesses, can be optimized as much as you want, as long as you preserve sanity at the racy accesses. So this gives high performance for data race 3 programs, and the beauty of it was that most programmers don't want to write racy programs anyway. If you have a race in the program, you didn't realize it, you called the data, it means there's a bug in your program regardless of the programming, regardless of the memory model. Okay? So that was great. And we tried to get a lot, people interested in this, wrote a bunch of papers, okay, but really not much traction from the hardware community. Okay, so this, you know, we were working in academia on this for a while, nothing much happened, and then in 2000 or so, well before 2000, Java came along, right? So this is arguably the first programming language that was a first multi-thread programming language that was commercially successful. Unfortunately, and it did have a memory model. That was a first too. All right, it did have a whole chapter in this specification book devoted to the memory model. Unfortunately, it was inscrutable. Okay, lots of bugs, lots of problems with it. And so Bill Pugh around 2000 asked me if I wanted to help with fixing this problem. I said, yes, of course, sure. Right, so what model should Java be? Well, of course it should be data race 3, right? So that's the model we want it to be. Unfortunately, with the data race 3 model, a program that has a race has no semantics. And with Java, if you have a data race in your program, not giving it semantics was not an option, because of Java's security guarantee. So you have to have some security safety guarantee, even if you have a race, right? And this was a really, really hard problem, okay? For those in the know, this has been called the no out of thin air values problem, and we spent a lot of time on this. At the end, we came up with a solution, but the solution was a big, big mess. Later on, bugs were found in it, not surprisingly, and it's still an unsolved problem. Okay, so with Java, data race 3 is at the core of Java. If you write data race 3 programs, you're good. you will get sequential consistency. But other than that, if you inadvertently have a bug, have a race in your program, it's a big mess. We don't have semantics. Okay? All right. Then in about right after that, Hans Bohm, who also worked with us on the Java memory model, he started leading this process for putting threads in C++ and coming up with a memory model for C++. And he asked me if I wanted to join that effort. And I said, yeah, sure. I mean, this is a piece of cake. C++, you know, has no safety and security guarantees, right? You want to have undefined semantics for racy programs. Who cares? That's fine, because there's undefined so much for so much of C++. So yeah, sure, I'll join the effort. It's got to be data race free, and we're done, right? Unfortunately, that's not how it turned out either. Okay, so it took a long time to convince people that we wanted to do data race 3 as the core model, but C++ is all about performance, okay? And unfortunately, the way we design hardware, I will not get into details of this, but there's a mismatch between what DRF wants and what is provided. And for that and some other reasons, there were some things about data race 3 that resulted, that did not please some programmers. They wanted more relaxations than DRF could offer, because the way hardware was built at that time, and it still is, these relaxations could give you high performance. And this relaxation is called relaxed atomics, and hopefully I'll get to that in the later part of my talk to give more details about what that means. So the result, again, was DRF again at the core, okay? But this big mess with relaxed atomics, again, people found problems with the way relaxed atomics were specified. Again, there's a bug in the specification. Again, it's still broken. Again, no solutions yet. Okay, so where we were in about 2008 was, you know, a lot of languages at that point, now Java, C++, C, and then many follow-ons as well, they all converged to the core of the data race 3 model, but then there was this big mess attached to it for programs that did not adhere to the data race 3 discipline. Still, you know, after 20 years, we still at least had convergence on the data race 3 aspect, so that was great, right? But at the end of this process, I was just like, okay, this is just nuts, right? I mean, we're talking about you know, such a fundamental property, what value a read can return, and we're not able to specify that. And so Hans and I wrote a paper in CSEM in 2010 saying, well, things are really broken, okay? We need to fix hardware and software in more fundamental ways to really fundamentally solve this problem. Okay, so around the same time, my colleague at Illinois, Vikram Adve, was working on a language that he called deterministic parallel Java, or DPJ, that avoided data races by design. Okay, so by construction, in this language, there were no data races. So when he talked to me about it, I was like, oh yes, this is what I really want, right? If I have no data races in the language, then data race 3 program consistency model is straightforward, right? You get, there's no problem of having data races and having to define semantics, et cetera, et cetera. This is what we really need. And so I started working with him on the language, but more importantly, from my point of view, the question that we asked in my group was, you know, if programmers started to use these disciplined, these more sane languages, then as hardware designers, how can we rethink hardware? How can we rebuild hardware so that it provides sanity, okay? So very big open question, but we started working on this. And this led to this project called De Novo that I've been working on over the last several years. The end result of this project is that we believe that we have really understood now what it means to provide coherence and how to build a coherence protocol that is more performance, energy, and complexity efficient than what we have today. Okay? So how did we do it? Again, we started with this basic premise of a disciplined parallel programming language. We used it to help us identify what is fundamentally required in hardware to provide what, you know, what a sane program will look like, okay? Now, once we identified these minimal coherence mechanisms, then at that point we said, hey, you know what? I mean, the rest of the world is not gonna you know, run to Vikram's language. Hardware vendors are not going to support just Vikram's language. So we need to now think about loosening the constraints on software and making it more what people will, you know, more of a universal theme, and in particular, you know, a general data race reprogram, not just DPJ. But now that we've done that whole analysis, right, gone through the process of identifying the fundamental issues, we were then able to show that, hey, even if I loosen the constraints on my software, even if I took regular data race tree software, my hardware, the de novo protocol that I designed, turns out we can actually use that for this software with the same benefits that we had for the more disciplined software. Okay, so we were very happy about this, right? We thought, okay, we've really discovered this fantastic protocol, and started talking to hardware people. And they all loved it, right? Oh, this is a great idea, okay? But I'm not gonna go change my coherence protocol. It's so ingrained in everything I do. Okay, so that sort of sat there. It was kind of disappointing, okay? We're still trying, but this is very ingrained in the hardware community. And then heterogeneous systems entered the picture. And it was deja vu all over again. Why is it deja vu? This is what my talk's going to be about. So initially, these systems, these accelerator-based systems, essentially the accelerator memories were all private memories. They're not part of the global address space. So these systems are not designed from the ground up for supporting a global address space with coherence, consistency, et cetera. But then as time went on, these systems became, you know, more aware that, okay, we have to have a global address space, which means you have to have coherence, we have to have, you know, caches, coherence, consistency, et cetera. Unfortunately, they are not designed from scratch to do that. And so, I'll show you in the talk, the process that's being used today is the same old deja vu. You know, I have that deja vu feeling, because we want to do this optimization, let's put this optimization. What do we do to handle this optimization? We change the consistency model, okay? Consistency models today in these systems are, again, vague, ambiguous, and complex, just like we had in the 80s and 90s for CPUs. And so my talk is then going to be, how do we deal with this problem, and how do we not fall into this trap all over again and get back into an even worse mess than we were in the CPU era. Okay. So next, I will start talking a little bit, you know, get more specific about what I mean in the context of heterogeneous systems. So here is a traditional heterogeneous system on chip memory hierarchy. Okay, I have several compute units on chip, but all of these compute units have memories attached to them, and these memories don't communicate with each other. And so if the CPU wants to talk to the GPU, for example, it has to send its data to main memory. GPU has to get it from main memory, perhaps through DMA or something like that. And this is, in general, a lot of inefficiency. Okay, lots of overhead being paid, and this is what this kills performance. But there is a growing realization that a tightly coupled memory hierarchy is needed, and GPUs, in fact, have been, in some sense, sort of at the bleeding edge of this. Now they are, you know, there's a lot of work on unified address space with GPUs and other accelerators. They have entered the mainstream. So now if the CPU and the accelerator want to communicate, they can communicate directly through their caches. They don't really have to go to main memory, and it's potentially more efficient than the last slide. The problem, however, is that once you have caches, then you need to talk about coherence, consistency, et cetera, and this is still inefficient, the way the GPUs do them today. And plus, because of these inefficiencies, then these systems also use specialized memories like scratch pads. These are still private memories, which means that any data in these memories then is not visible to anybody else, and so needs to go through main memory just like before. Okay, so The rest of my talk has three parts to deal with these problems of programmability and efficiency. The first part, which is where I'll spend the bulk of my time, is going to be on efficient coherence, especially looking at how systems do coherence today and what de novo brings to the table. Then, if I have time, I will talk about the relaxed atomics problem and our solution to it. And finally, how to integrate. So there's still room for specialization in memory systems. Of course, this is all about specialization. You still want things like scratch pads. I will talk about how you can build memories like scratch pads that give the benefits of scratch pads, but make them part of the global address space so that they're more efficient in the sense that when you communicate between two such memories, you don't have to go to main memory and deal with those inefficiencies. Okay, so let's talk about efficient coherence or de novo then. And in this talk, my focus, my examples, and my evaluations will be on systems with CPUs and GPUs that have caches and scratch pads, but the ideas I'm going to talk about apply to all accelerators and all types of specialized memories, not just scratch pads. Okay. Okay. So, on a CPU, when I want to do coherence, okay, the typical way we do it is using an MSI or MESI or MOSI, what have you, protocol. But the key invariant we think about, the way we think about coherence is single writer, multiple reader, right? Pick any textbook, that's where it starts with. Which means that on a write miss, you want to go get ownership and be the single owner of some data, right? And you want to invalidate all the sharers of that data. So you send all these invalidations out, collect all the acknowledgments, and that's what you do. On a read miss, you get the data from whoever has it, but you add yourself to a sharer list so that everybody knows that you have the data as well. So what this means in a CPU is that you're implicitly talking about some sort of directory to store this sharers list. You're talking about many transient states in your protocol. So even though I say this is an MSI protocol or a three-state protocol, and that's what a textbook will tell you, any real implementation will have tens of states in it, not just three. And these tens of states are transient states to deal with all these multiple actions like sending out invalidations and worrying about how an invalidation might race with another request and so on and so forth. And these create a lot of complexity in the protocol. Finally, you have excessive traffic. As I said, this invalidation traffic, for example, lots of indirection through the directory to tell the directory that, hey, I'm sharing, et cetera, and lots of inefficiencies associated with that. So overall, this the CPU coherence is complex and also inefficient, okay? The complexity part certainly doesn't jive very well with heterogeneous systems, because these systems have been designed to be extremely energy efficient, usually are simple, okay, and building such a complex protocol in a system like that is used to be a non-starter, okay? So if you look at what GPUs did, right? NVIDIA's GPUs, AMD GPUs, et cetera. As I said in the beginning, they did not even have real coherence, right? Leave alone a consistency model. But slowly, as we started building in caches and started running applications that had synchronization in them, the ideas emerged. And if you take today's GPUs, the de facto sort of memory model, okay, even though some of them have not quite declared their model yet, but the de facto model is data race free, okay? And with this data race free model, again, the idea is no data races, any synchronization has to be explicitly distinguished. At all synchronization points, what these GPUs do is that they flush all the dirty data. Okay, so at a synchronization point, if I had written anything in my cache, I will flush that out into the shared cache that is next in the memory hierarchy. Okay, so that makes sure that at synchronization, anything that I wrote is now visible to everyone else, as long as the remote caches do the second point here, which is to invalidate all data. Okay, so at a synchronization, I also invalidate everything that's in my cache. Okay, so flush all the dirty stuff as well as invalidate everything in my cache. So synchronization, it becomes a very heavyweight operation. Okay. Moreover, all the synchronization accesses in GPUs today have to happen at the last level cache. Okay, and this is going to change, but de facto, that's what it is. Okay, synchronization accesses must go to the last level cache. So again, synchronization is extremely inefficient. Now, this works fine if synchronization isn't that common. Right? If it is common, then you have a real problem here. Okay. So of course, this is simple, very simple. Only at synchronization you do all this stuff, but it's very, very inefficient at synchronization. So what do we do? Okay, so this is not sustainable. What do? Of course, we do what architects have always done, which is come up with a new consistency model. Okay? And so what GPUs then do today, really, if you have synchronization, you're doing this at every synchronization, you get killed. And so what they really use is another model that folks at AMD and Wisconsin wrote a really nice paper in AS+14 that formalized this model as heterogeneous race free. Okay, what does this model do? Well, it's similar to data race free. All right, so still has no data races, and synchronizations need to be explicitly distinguished. But the key is that each synchronization access is required to associate a scope with it. So the programmer is responsible to say whether a synchronization will have global scope or local scope or some other scope. What does scope mean? Scope means what level of the memory hierarchy this synchronization needs to be done at. It's a very hardware-related issue. Okay, the programmer has to know at what level of the memory hierarchy this synchronization should occur, who is sharing this data, okay, and where, how far should these synchronization accesses go. The solution works in terms of performance, in the sense that now, instead of doing this heavyweight stuff at all synchronization points, I need to do it only at global synchronization points. Okay, so I flush and invalidate only at global synchronization points. Only global synchronization accesses have to get done at the LSC. If it's a locally scoped synchronization, there's no overhead at all. So that's great. Except, again, deja vu, it's a hardware-centric solution to what should really be a software-based interface. Okay, so much higher programming complexity because the hardware is not designed well enough. All right, so here's the lay of the land with GPUs today. Okay, we have a de facto consistency model of data race free, which is simple, but the coherence protocol is such that there's high overhead on synchronization, and so it's inefficient. More recently, we have the HRF or heterogeneous race-free model with scope synchronization, which is complex. With coherence, though, what this allows us to do is no overhead on local synchronization, which makes it more efficient for local synchronization. But really, the question to ask here is, do these GPU models, such as HRF, really have to be more complex than CPU models such as DRF? I mean, isn't this a problem complex enough for CPUs? Haven't we already, pulled our hair enough in the CPU world that we have to make GPUs and other accelerators even more complex? Well, my response to this is no, definitely not. Not if we can get coherence right. The problem here is the coherence protocol that the hardware designers have. Okay, so what coherence protocol can we use? So we took de novo and applied it in a heterogeneous context and showed that de novo plus DRF, which is the de facto CPU model, works just fine. Okay, it is efficient and it's a simpler memory model. So what does de novo do? Okay, so for this, we have to think about coherence protocols a little bit differently, and here's how I view them. All right. So what is coherence really trying to do? Well, there are two cases. The first one is, so it's all about what value a read should return, right? That's what it is. So when you do a read, it either hits or misses. Right? If it hits, you shouldn't return stale data. That's all there is to it. If it misses, then you should be able to find one up-to-date copy of the data so that you can get the data in your cache. Okay? Now, here is a table that essentially summarizes most of what I've learned through this exercise. Okay? So again, read hit, you don't want to return stale data. Read miss, you want to find one up-to-date memory copy. Okay? And don't return stale data essentially means that you invalidate stale data from your cache. Right? So there are two aspects. How do you do these invalidations, and how do you track up-to-date copies? In many protocols, invalidation is done through a write. When you do a write, you invalidate all the sharers. In de novo, or in some protocols, invalidations can be done at the reader. The reader agrees to self-invalidate its data. Okay, so it invalidates its own cache. For tracking up-to-date copies, again, two options. One is through ownership. Get ownership of the data and keep track of that. And the other is through these write-throughs, where you every time you write a data, you send the data down to the shared last level cache, and so that shared last level cache always has up-to-date data. Okay, so where messy falls in this chart is with ownership for tracking up-to-date data and writer-initiated invalidations. GPUs do write-through for tracking and do reader-initiated invalidations. What de novo does is it combines ownership for tracking and does reader-initiated invalidations. Okay, what reader-initiated invalidations gives me is that we don't have this writer-initiated multiple invalidations on a transaction, so there's no extraneous traffic, there's no directories, because you don't need to keep track of who's sharing what. There are no transient states. In fact, the de novo protocol has exactly three states. There are no transient states. Obtaining ownership for written data, what that gives me is the ability to reuse own data in my cache. If I know that I own this data, nobody else has it, then I don't have to keep, you know, writing it through. I don't have to tell anybody when I'm doing stuff on this data. So I can reuse that data, just like in the messy protocol. I don't need to flush it at synchronization points, et cetera. Okay? So essentially, here's how de novo coherence works with DRF in a GPU. Okay, so the words, the text here is what we had to do with GPUs today, with current GPU protocols, and this is how we modify it with de novo. Okay, so instead of, at a synchronization point, instead of flushing all dirty data, okay, we simply obtain ownership for the data. Okay, instead of invalidating all dirty data, okay, we invalidate only the non-owned data, because the owned data we don't have to invalidate. Okay, and even for when I said we have to bring ownership, of course, if you already have ownership for data because you use that data, nobody else is using it, you can keep that data in your cache. You don't have to bring ownership again. It's a local operation. You don't have to do anything, right? And synchronization access, so what this lets us do is that we can reuse all of the data that we own in our cache without bothering anybody. Okay? As far as synchronization accesses themselves, earlier we had to go to the LLC, but now if I own the synchronization variable, it's again a local operation, and I can continue to do it in my L1 cache. Okay? So this requires about 3% extra state overhead compared to GPU coherence, okay, which is not much at all right, and is much more efficient. All right, so I will show you the efficiency in the next few slides. So the configurations we studied are de novo plus DRF, all right, which invalidates all non-owned data at synchronization points. De novo plus read-only plus DRF, where we do one small optimization, where we avoid invalidating read-only data at synchronization points because we know this data is fine. And then de novo plus HRF, because you know, nobody says you can't use the complicated consistency model with de novo, so we wanted to see how much better we could get. So here we reuse the valid data if synchronization is locally scoped. Okay. So this picture just, this chart just essentially lays out the optimizations that all of these variations allow us. I'm not going to go through this. I'll just skip through the actual results to show that if I have global synchronization, right? So no local synchronization here. Just the program is such that it's all globally scoped synchronization. And so HRF is not really valid here because HRF really doesn't do anything unless I have local synchronization. The blue bars are with GPU coherence. The green bars are with de novo coherence. And you can see that de novo has 28% lower execution time than GPU with global synchronization. Okay. As far as energy goes, de novo has 51% lower energy than GPU with global synchronization. Now, if I have local synchronization, then HRF comes into play, okay? And the dark blue bar is GPU coherence with DRF. The light blue bar is GPU coherence with HRF, right? And this is the AS+14. The HRF paper showed already that, yes, HRF does a lot better than DRF, right, if I use basic GPU coherence. And indeed, that's what we see. But now if we use de novo, again, the green bar here, de novo with DRF and compare it with GPU coherence, today's GPU coherence with HRF, you see that de novo with DRF, de novo with the simpler consistency model is comparable when you have local synchronization. Okay? And keep in mind that I already showed previous slides that if you have global synchronization, then de novo with DRF is much better than GPU with DRF. Okay, so here we are comparable now with a more complicated consistency, even though we have a simpler consistency model. Okay, so similar performance now, but there are cases where you know de novo does a little bit worse. So if we do the read-only optimization, then that gap goes away as well. And then if you're really, really, really dying to do HRF with de novo, you can do that, and it is certainly the best, but by hardly much. Okay, so the point here is that if we fix the coherence protocol, if we fix the hardware, we can continue to use the simpler consistency model, and we should do that. Okay? Complicating the consistency model is not worthwhile. In fact, we wrote this paper in Micro 2015, and at the last Micro, 1 year later, a subset of the original authors of the HRF paper wrote a paper that showed some improvements to a protocol, you know, such as de novo, and then also concluded, yes, we don't need scope synchronization. We can do as well without scopes. So, you know, this is not coming from a company yet, but it is a win, all right? It was really nice to see those results coming out. Okay. All right. So that's about the coherence protocol affecting consistency models. Right? Now, so the scoped synchronization was one issue with GPUs. And I should add that the scoped synchronization, the HRF paper then went on to be what is now the HSA memory model. The Heterogeneous System Architecture Foundation came up with their memory model, and that's essentially HRF. Okay, so I neglected to mention that earlier. Okay, so I think we have a handle on the scopes problem now, but the next big tricky part is this idea of relaxed atomics in heterogeneous systems. So I have a few minutes. I'm just going to give a very, very quick sketch of what the issue is there and what our solution is. So relaxed atomics relates to atomics, which is the word, it's an unfortunate use of terminology, but when we say atomics, what we're talking about are synchronization operations. Okay, they're referred to as atomics in C++, et cetera, parlance, volatiles in Java parlance. That's the way it is. Okay, so RACI synchronization accesses are implemented with atomics. With data race 3.0, okay, the constraints on the atomics are as follows. The first column in under allowed reorderings here says whether data and data are allowed to be reordered, and the answer to that is always yes. And the next column says, are synchronization and data allowed to be reordered with respect to each other? And you can see that you can do that in some cases. The last column says whether sync and sync are allowed to be reordered with respect to each other, and the answer to that is no for data race-free, okay? This is for most, for normal implementations, unless you do something very, very more complicated. These are the orderings that are typically allowed, okay? And the last column says, does this model retain sequentially consistent semantics? And the answer is yes. If your data race-free, you get sequential consistency. Okay, so the problem that the relaxed atomics folks are trying to address is that big cross under the sync-sync column, which says two synchronization axes cannot be reordered at all. Okay, a smaller problem is sync data column, where some programmers want to do some more reorderings. Okay, so how do we deal with this problem? Well, it's part of my original work, my thesis work. I also had a data race-free one model where we introduced another type of synchronization called unpaired synchronization. And the idea there was that sync and data could be reordered fairly extensively if for certain types of synchronizations that we refer to as unpaired. Now, this was not very important in the CPU world, because these types of reorderings did not give that much performance benefit. But in the GPU world, where synchronization is so heavyweight, okay, any kind of reordering allowed with respect to synchronization is good. Okay, so this comes back into the picture. But this still does not affect that last column with the cross in it, and that's where relaxed atomics come in. And what relaxed atomics say is that if you identify certain synchronizations as relaxed, okay, then these synchronizations can be reordered with respect to each other, as well as reordered with respect to other data accesses. Now, when can you identify something as relaxed? Programmer has to figure it out. What are the semantics for the program when you do this type of thing? As I said, no one knows, okay? So C++ today literally does not provide any semantics when you use relaxed atomics, because the original semantics are broken, there was a bug, and we don't know what to do with it. Okay, but so this was known. When we did the C++ model, it was known that these relaxed atomics are difficult to deal with. Okay, so when, for example, Hans and I wrote our paper on the C++ model, we said very clearly, okay, do not use relaxed atomics. Programmers should not use relaxed atomics. These are only present for expert programmers who want to do supercritical performance coding and can deal with reasoning about how things happen, et cetera. And even they make mistakes all the time. Okay? So with CPUs, we could actually say this with a straight face, that most of you don't use relaxed atomics. The problem with GPUs and heterogeneous systems today, again, is that because synchronization is so heavyweight in today's systems, these types of optimizations of reordering synchronization give huge benefits. And so it is too tempting to use these relaxed atomics. And so then we said, okay, let's try and solve this problem, right? How do we do this without, issues? So using de novo helps, all right? So we did a bunch of evaluations and showed that using de novo does help, but even with de novo, there are some cases where doing these optimizations enables us to get better performance than you could get with DRF0 or DRF1. Okay, so we said, all right, let's then try and solve this problem. And the question we asked was, can we utilize additional software information formalize, just like we did for data race free, okay? Formalize, what is it? What is it about these synchronization accesses that allows us to do these optimizations? Can we describe them in a way that programmers can then tell us, okay, yeah, these, you know, these synchronization accesses solve, obey the properties you're asking me for, and then we give sequential consistency while doing, while allowing optimizations for those. So anyway, the way we went about doing that was we did a huge survey of how programmers use relaxed atomics and try and categorize the different relaxed atomics and then show that we could reorder them with while still giving sequential consistency style semantics. That work is still under review. I'm going to not go over the details of that, but hopefully we will get a handle, you know, on this this problem. through this technique, but still remains to be seen. So I'm going to spend just a couple of minutes then on integrating specialized memories in the global address space. Okay, so we have some time for questions. So again, specialized memories for efficiency because we want to be more and more energy efficient, right? Examples of these are scratch pads, FIFOs, stream buffers, et cetera. We're going to focus on scratch pad and caches here. So the nice thing about scratch pads is that they're directly addressed. You know, have no tags, TLB, conflicts, et cetera. They have compact storage. There are no holes in the cache line when you compare with caches. The nice thing about caches, though, is that they're part of the global address space quite naturally. You have implicit data movement. You can get data in on loads and stores implicitly. You can have coherence, reuse, lazy writebacks, et cetera. And the question we asked was, can these specialized memories then also be globally addressable and coherent? Okay? Can we have our scratch pad and cache it too? Okay. And we showed that indeed, we could do that with a design that we call the stash, where we provide direct addressability and compact storage, just like a scratch pad, and we have a global address space and coherence, just like a cache. Okay, so we've made specialized memories globally addressable and coherent, gives efficient address mapping and an efficient coherence protocol, and we've showed that these that a stash compared with scratch pads and caches is a lot more efficient, up to 31% less execution time and 51% less energy. All right. So the next step is to do this for all of our all the different types of specialized memories out there, so that we don't have to make this false choice, this dichotomy between private versus global, specialized versus general kind of memory. Okay, so to conclude, there's a tension between programmability and efficiency. Coherence performs poorly for emerging apps in these heterogeneous systems. Consistency is complicated. Relaxed atomics worsen this. Specialized models, specialized memories are not visible in global address space. Our insight has been to adjust coherence and consistency complexity. We provide efficient coherence, DRF consistency model, specialized memory in the global address space. Future is to continue to optimize de novo, integrate more specialized memories, and provide a better, and provide a more effective interface. So this was my story. I hope that this feeling of deja vu goes away in a little while. Questions?